Thank you for auditing Professor Skye's record review, the always positive new music review show hosted by a French professor who's choosing a very spicy title for this episode, Is Kid Cudi Secretly Boring? Now, first of all, I should say, I know next to nothing about Kid Cudi, okay? I'm going to admit my ignorance up front. As I like to say, my ignorance is profound, meaning there's a lot of it, and also there's something interesting in that ignorance. There's a kind of freedom from not being weighed down from the history of an artist, approaching a project like this, Man on the Moon 3, without ever having heard Man on the Moon 1 or 2. Now, I, of course, know his work with Kanye fairly well, because I do love Kanye. Kid See Ghost was my favorite album in 2018. It was the best album of that year. I know that he is very well appreciated as being one of the people who brought psychological difficulty and trauma and depression into hip-hop. I watched every episode of Comedy Bang Bang where he featured, and I thought he was quite funny there. But musically, I have to admit that I am the Rip Van Winkle of music. When I turned about 23, I died. And then now, in my early 40s, I am alive again and I'm listening to new music. And I was so excited to review this album by Kid Cudi because I like 808 and Heartbreak so much, and I know that he had a huge part in that, because I love Kid See Ghost, because I love Comedy Bang Bang, okay? Like, I was so excited for this person to actually take the time to sit down and listen to his music. But let's just play devil's advocate here. Let's be provocative. You know, he's listed as an indie rapper, And he certainly has an air around him of being this really vital and fascinating and different new artist. But let's play devil's advocate. Let's put forth for a couple minutes that he's not. I mean, lyrically, is he doing anything particularly interesting or inventive now? Maybe if he recorded this 10 years ago, which he must have because this is the third version. But right now, an entire album dedicated to the same theme. I am an unhappy person. And money, fame, women, and substance abuse serve as distractions. An hour of that, a straight hour of that theme. A sad sack, emo rapper, I'm so rich, boo hoo hoo, I'm so sad, I cut myself, I'm an alcoholic, relentless self-pity, conspicuous consumption, and spiritual emptiness. How does this really differentiate itself from Juice WRLD or Post Malone, lyrically and thematically, with this theme of I'm so sad and I'm such a loser for partying so hard? Stylistically, okay, there's a lot of interesting variation between singing and rapping, but I've heard that quite a bit. So much emo, kind of like auto-tune feelings about his pain and about his suffering and about the hell inside him and the devil inside him, but a lot of people do this. Mixed in is a lot of these kind of real 2020 ad-libs. Yeah! Yeah! And when he actually does straight rap, it's not always that innovative either. His flow isn't particularly interesting. He does a lot of feminine rapping, you know, like kind of triplet-y adjacent flow. I mean, you sort of have to ask the question, is this really alternative? And even the production, a lot of the production on this project matches what I'm talking about with the lyrics. You know, you have the kind of trap hi-hats, a little bit of drill elements here and there, some EDM. But there wasn't a single song on this entire project where I went, God damn, that's a well-produced track. Ooh, listen to that again. Oh, it came close a couple times, but there's no point. There's no real standout point. But all of that is just goofing around. This is an always positive review show. Okay, I would never make an entire video explaining why Kid Cudi is boring. That is boring. Talking about why people are bad, I think, is boring. But I think it should be said, what is it that makes this artist go beyond all of those elements that I just described? What is it in the combination of these elements in this artist that makes this album very good, very listenable, and very important? There's actually one lyric from this album that I'm going to talk about soon, which I think illustrates exactly why. But before I get into that one line, I think the main thing that he's able to do is emit a vibe. He has a charisma, a personality that comes through. You believe his pain the way that he sings it. It might be his particular combination of singing and rapping. You never quite know what's going to come next. The way that he sings and raps, like, you never know how any line is going to end. And the way that he raps, he often doesn't even rhyme. He doesn't even really focus on that. It feels so direct and so, like, bleeding out of him without ever feeling steeped in, like, true self-pity. You know, like, there's a sort of irony and a detachment that he's able to project. And maybe that's because he's a comedian, right? I mean, he was funny on Comedy Bang Bang, right? He wasn't just there. He wasn't just a musical guy. He was funny. Not as funny as Reggie Watts, but he was funny. So he plays so well with meter and words. You never know what to expect every line. You believe his pain. And then as far as production goes, okay, it is true. Not a single track on this album made me jump out of my seat and go, that's amazing. My biggest complaint about this is a complaint I often have with artists like Kid Cudi or Kanye, where it's like, you're a producer, produce. Like, you're one of these guys who can do it all. Why, when you look at the producer list, there's like 8 people long? Well, I think he's following Kanye's school, which is he is a producer in the larger sense and in the smaller sense. So in the larger sense of somebody who knows how to get a lot of people together and doing something great, right? That's why Kanye is the greatest producer now, not because he knows how to make the best beats, but he knows how to get the people who make the best beats all together. And in a similar way, it's very clear there's a unified vision on here. And some clearly, Kid Cudi is doing a lot in the studio and making beats and here and there. But more is that there's this unified theme and emotion and feeling and tone all the way throughout the album. So you can say that it's boring, but it's boring in the way that a good movie about an interesting theme is boring, right? I mean, you don't have to have, you know, people with clown hats, you know, shooting children for it to be emotional or interesting or scary, right? Like, you can develop things in a subtle way. And this album, even though it's the same thing over and over and over again, does have a certain subtlety to it. You could almost say that the lack of, like, development throughout the album, because the album is theoretically about him overcoming these problems, but all the way throughout, it's clear that he doesn't. And the lack of the development, I think, reflects a certain realness. I would say this whole album is weird because it has a lot of pretensions to it, right? The fact that it's part 3. And again, I haven't watched part 1 or part 2. But you look at the back cover of the album, you can see it online, and he divides everything into 4 sections. Act 1, Act 2, Act 3, Act 4. Okay, take it easy, buddy. And then there's even this, like, blurb. The credits on the album are given, like, movie credits, and then there's a blurb. He must face himself and fight to win back his soul from the evil Mr. Rager. So apparently Mr. Rager is the alter ego that he has who parties and does all these things that help make him so sad. And my initial instinct is just to be like, oh, come on, all right, you're just trying too hard to make just a simple project with one idea seem more grand than it is. But I think it is grand. I think it's grand because ultimately it doesn't seem like he really grows. It seems like he can't grow. And in that way, it is an accurate depiction of the pain of recidivism, okay? That actually sounds like a word he would say in his lyrics. Recidivismism. Like, recidivism, falling back into your own ways. This whole album is about that. It is about falling into your old ways, about how those old ways reflect your inner pain and the inability to get out of them. So the whole album does that, and it does it very well. I can't tell you all the reasons why it's not boring, because so much of the reason that it's not boring just comes from the timbre of his voice, just comes from this believability, and that makes it a great work of art. Definitely, we're very much still in the legacy of 808 and Heartbreak. I mean, that's not exactly the world's most I'm not on the forefront of thinking with that, but still, the fact that he helped to create that album, I think, also gives him a lot of authority in this whole genre. Because just that idea of this weakness and acknowledging your weaknesses and your vulnerabilities and your struggles with mental health gives him a sort of authority to do this that also elevates the entire project. So I'm not going to go too deep into each track, but I am going to spend a lot of time on the first one, which is the track that he produced. Well, not the first track. The first track is an instrumental overture made by Phineas, one of 2 things he's on here, the guy who is half of Billie Eilish. Really the first real track is called Tequila Shots, and it lays out the template of the entire album. And really, it's the vulnerability of his voice, too, that's just so good. Like, he has, like, such an appealing voice, you know? Like, just, you know, just some people just have an appealing voice, right? Like, not me, but some people have an appealing voice. And he has that, and he's able to express his sadness and his weakness through it. And he just wears that emotional disturbance on his voice. A very good catchy chorus, Can't Stop This, War In Me, just lays it out. This is going to be the whole album. Apparently, the entire first verse, according to Lyric Genius, is really self-referential and all about his previous catalog. I don't know. I don't care. I don't care about his previous catalog. In my world, this is all of Kid Cudi. Let me tell you my favorite part about this whole album is the second verse on this track. First of all, he inhales just slightly before the second verse. I don't know why, but I hear that inhale, and to me, that highlights that it's going to be important. Second thing that makes it important, he doesn't rhyme even once. Now, rhyming is an important thing. The thing that I love about hip-hop, and I talk about it a lot, is that it's a mix between spoken word and poetry. And I think people often spend too much time trying to justify rap as poetry, as though it needs external justification. It's fine, I don't think it does, but it's okay if you think it does. But in some ways it goes beyond that, beyond the poetic, because it's in between these two different ways of being. But by abandoning the rhyming, he's able to just get straight, you know, that's how you know you're tapped into this emotional vein, right? Because he can't even rhyme. And then we get to my favorite lyric, the one that I said I would talk about, that to me is the essence of why Kid Cudi is not boring. Quote, "I am not just some sad dude." That's the lyric. "I am not just some sad dude." In that one line is a self-awareness of how, in some ways, his patheticness or the way that he talks about his fragility might diminish him in the eyes of others. More than that, about how you can be tempted when you have these kinds of struggles with mental health, especially if it's depression and you get really self-involved, you can think that that defines you and what makes you interesting. And also, it's just a funny line. It's a funny line in the middle of a song about this war in me and I'm struggling and Mr. Rager and I'm this. I'm not just some sad dude. And that is true. I should have titled this video, Kid Cudi is not just some sad dude. But you get more clicks if you ask an annoying question and get the fans in and get ready to get mad at you. I can't help it. I like clicks. I mean, I don't like clicks enough to like review stuff I don't like. Those are empty clicks, but I like good clicks, you know? And I like asking questions like this, right? What makes him not boring? I'm gonna play you a little bit of it just so you get a sense of the soundscape and the way that he rhymes. And like what I'm talking about is this unpredictability. We don't quite know where he's going to go. This is produced by him and his co-producer, Dot Da Genius, who apparently, based on my very limited research, has worked with him from the beginning, is sort of like his other half. So that's kind of nice. That this is a little bit less group produced. Okay, and one thing I'll say is listening to the album three times, I liked it increasingly. So the first time I was maybe looking for more of a standout, but then as it grows and as it builds, you just like it and you just get more in that space, just in that space. And I think in the liner notes, he says it's about one night and it feels like that. It feels like it's one night of internal struggle and strife that you're trying to get through. The next track is called Another Day. Nice kind of staccato rapping with some auto-tuner. Goes very nicely with these nice kind of thumps underneath, this kind of thumpy drum beat. He just talks about, you know, the same old person and the same old pain. He seems actually frustrated with it. And this is another thing. If an artist is talking to you about their struggles with addiction or depression, and they only do one album about it, it might not have been real. You know, like serious mental health conditions and serious chemical dependencies, they live with you forever. You don't get to just say, I'm better. We're in the last 10 minutes of this sitcom, so here's the resolution, right? There is no resolution. And again, that authenticity comes through in a song like this. And the idea, thank God I saw another day, and he's fighting against Mr. Rager, which is a pretty lame name for an alter ego. I'm sorry, Kid Cudi. It's not that good. Okay. She Knows This is the next track. Starts off with a quote from Scott Pilgrim. So Scott Pilgrim, Castaway, and Stand By Me are the three movies that are quoted in this. Not very predictable, but nice. It's nice when movies are quoted and you can tell that they're off the beaten path. They're very much chosen by someone who really wants to say it. This is, I think, a sex song, but it's not gross. So that puts it in the 0.00000000001% of rap sex songs that don't make me go, ugh. Skip that one. Because it doesn't really, he doesn't go into graphic detail, doesn't talk too much about himself. Cool kind of production with whistling in the back. You don't hear a lot of whistling. Just kind of mixes in with the sex stuff. Lines like, I climbed out of a treacherous, bottomless pit. Kind of a boring chorus, but it's catchy at the same time. And then at a certain point, it speeds up. And anytime a song speeds up, especially in the modern era where we have everything on computers and everything is very well synced and timed and locked and popped and all that, it's nice to have something speed up. It's a little bit unexpected. And the outro has some pretty wild arpeggiators, like Falling into Dissolution. He does a lot of great work with outros, with a lot of different sections to his songs. His songs do have movement. They start one place and they end another, and that's another thing that adds a lot to this project. The track Dive, it's kind of a rock and roll guitar to start. I guess, you know, one thing I've heard about him and I know about him is his love of rock and roll, and that does come through in here. Just kind of, again, falling into badness, talking about these vibes that he needs, but just constantly saying, that's just the sadness in me, that's just the sadness. Next part of the album is Rager of the Menace, with a track called Damaged, and it's weird. This track is sort of like the best and the worst of the album. I don't really know how, like, just the chorus is, this is how it is when you're a damaged man, and it's just so direct. It's just so simple. It's like, really? You're not going to spruce this up at all? This is how it is when you're a damaged man. It's kind of cheesy, but interesting, and above all, the honesty sticks out. Heaven on Earth has really cool kind of bell sounds in the production, almost like a low siren. Kind of a typical boring flow, kind of a triplety flow, and then at the end with, yeah! And he keeps talking about rock and roll. It's one of my biggest pet peeves when rap artists call themselves rock stars. I think rock stars are boring, and I think rappers saying they're rock stars is even more boring than rock stars. But still, this track is a good example of why I like this album the second time. The second time I listened to this, I was pent up. I do that thing where I walk 10,000 steps a day. I'm like obsessed. Like if I don't do it, I like walk around the house like a border collie. Like it's crazy. So, see, I went for a walk and I was listening to this album and it was too cold for me to type up my notes like I normally do. So I just kind of try to keep everything in my head. And I came up with the whole general concept of, is he boring? Is he not? That whole thing. But then, like, while I was walking, you know, by some friends of mine up on Hilltop, the street next to mine, I'm walking through and it's like lightly snowing and I'm listening to this and I can't help it. I'm just listening to the song Heaven on Earth and I got my winter gloves on and I'm just listening to it and I'm just, while I'm walking, I'm clapping along with the beat, you know? I don't know why, but the fact it was able to like get me to do that, to walk around my neighborhood kind of like an idiot, you know, just like walking, all the Christmas lights everywhere, and I'm all like clapping because I was able to get into it so much. It does have the whole album has a really good driving feeling where once you're in the mood of it, once you are in the atmosphere, it's very satisfying. And maybe that's part of the reason why it could be boring, because if the whole album is so unified and you're not into it, you're like, okay, enough. But it was that point where I started doing the clapping with the gloves and the sound that makes. It made me realize part of what makes this album so good is pretty indescribable. How do I describe I'm clapping with gloves on, right? That's a pretty personal thing. That's not a very objective notice. Next track is called Show Out with Skepta and Pop Smoke. Kind of a drillish beat, I guess, because he's on there with Pop Smoke and a British guy, Skepta. Skepta has a pretty good verse on here, and Pop Smoke has the chorus, but you know, he's dead. Sadly, he was killed. And his chorus is like, it's sort of like what they've been doing with Old Dirty Bastard for the last 20 years, where they find like old footage of him being like, okay, what's up? Uh-huh. Wu-Tang. And then they just like, they loop it and they pretend like it's a chorus. And this one, it's basically just Pop Smoke being like, okay, let's go. Here we are. Let's go. But it works. And I reviewed Pop Smoke album and that's another one. I'm like, why do I like this? This should be bad, but it's just not. So I really do like this track as well. Mr. Solo Dolo 3. I've never listened to Mr. Solo Dolo 1 or 2. But really nice drum beat comes in, just more and more of the self-pity. We hit Act 3, Heart of Rose Gold, a song called Sad People. More of this, just sad. He even talks about having scars on his arms. You know, excuse me, I didn't know that I walked into a Hot Topic joke. But there you go, okay? It's not a joke. It's real, and you can feel it. The next track is one of the highlights of the album, Elsie's Baby Boy. Anytime an artist sings directly about the relationship with their parents, it is an immediate success. Like, you can't, if you are singing honestly about your parents, you've done it. Like, I don't know why every artist doesn't, like, literally every artist should do it, right? I mean, let's just think of one of the best examples, John Lennon's Mother, right? You left me, but I never left you. I mean, that's a simple line. That's just inverting one sentence after another, but that's one of his most powerful songs. And rappers, when they can truly talk about the relationship with their parents, it is very moving. And that's what we have here in Elsie's Baby Boy. It has like almost like a House of the Rising Sun guitar lift. Down, 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 down. And it seems to be talking and forgiving his parents. That seems to be what he's working on. And talking about being bored in the winter. Apparently, Kid Cudi is from Cleveland, like Devo, Pere Ubu. And that's, you know, I live in Western New York, which is basically Cleveland. And that does have an interesting idea here, just being bored in the winter, just like being bored and trying to get out of it and trying to find things to do. So many themes of this kind of like almost minimalist, indie, hip hop. And then there's just gorgeous verse about his father's funeral. And wow, it's really well made. It's not cheap. It all fits in really well. And the sense that you get of this guy who's trying to be a man and figure out what it is to be a man while also forgiving his parents for how they were when he was a child or how they weren't, it's an amazing song. And it's one of the parts of this album that makes you realize, right. Why did this jerk even ask if Kid Cudi is boring? September 16th is the other track with Phineas. I guess that's about his girlfriend, according to Rap Genius. This doesn't fit on the album, actually. I don't like this song. I like this song. It just doesn't belong here. Like, maybe it can go somewhere else. I'm not even going to talk about it. It's a good song, but it doesn't belong here. This isn't about this whole theme, I don't think. You know, this album isn't about like, oh, I found love and now I'm safe and now I'm okay. So what is this? I don't know. Then we get back to The Void, back to sort of rock and roll, emo style. This one's primarily produced by the Phantom Menace, Mike Dean, who's like, I don't know how responsible Mike Dean is for music of the last decade, but he is very responsible. He's the person behind, next to Kanye, helping Kanye realize his dream, helping Kid Cudi realize his dream. He's an amazing person, an amazing producer. A very kind of catchy and cool song, just again falling into the void. Nice though, the song develops a little bit during the second verse, and then it ends with a kind of very long, extended Kanye-style auto-tune outro. Thank you, God, everything's gonna be okay. Just sort of a long ad-lib auto-tune singing part. Loving Me is the next track with Phoebe D. Bridgers. I realized if I had a pet badger, I would name it Phoebe. If I had two, those are my Phoebe badgers. Phoebe Bridgers, and this feels like it's a very intentionally grand song, you know, the fact that he's working with Phoebe Bridgers is quite, you know, one of the most relevant, interesting artists now. I reviewed a Christmas song last week, check it out. but like, it has a very grand feel, and it's his best singing on here. I don't really hear too much auto-tune in it, just the dynamics of his voice are able to come through. His natural voice is here, this is just the hell inside. Phoebe's verse matches really well. It's a great mixture. The production's a great mixture between sort of indie rock and hip hop. And then all is around the theme of learning to love yourself, which is super important. And then at the end, they have a cool kind of like duet with sort of like La La La's from Phoebe Bridgers and Ayo by Kid Cudi. And it's a really good track. Then we hit the fourth act, Power, with Pale Moonlight. Very far out production. Apparently this is by Ratatat, a group that I remember sort of liking when I heard them. But the interesting kind of EDM sound here, offbeat rhythms, cool kind of humming in the background, and the best chorus on the album is in this one, just great singing, rapping, and just the whole theme of recidivism. And then my favorite lyrics, well, not my favorite lyrics, my favorite lyrics are, I'm more than just a sad dude, but one of my favorite choruses in here is he says, in the mirror, used to hate what I see, healing, but I'm dealing with some things, shit'll never stop. And just this idea of him seeing himself in the mirror and no longer hating what he sees, like that's the growth. Like that's the minor incremental growth. There's no like, I am done. I am fixed of being crazy and sad. Instead, it's like, I used to hate what I see. I'm healing, but I'm still dealing. And that's what the album is really all about. Next track is called Rockstar Nights. I wonder if this track belongs on the album as well. It's with Trippie Redd. And I just hate this whole rock star theme. But he has a really nice verse again on this, his second verse, just super sing-songy and self-pity, we free and we are lonely. For the kids, it's kind of a you are not alone song. It's sort of dedicated to the listener. And this is a sort of messianic side of Kid Cudi, where like he's going to lead us. And after describing hopeless emptiness, he's going to help you out by saying that he knows what it's like and you can make it out. Since day one, I've been trying to feel alive. So, and also just as a good example of his kind of meter and rhymes, everything's copacetic, push the limit. That's sort of a great unit of Kid Cudi lyric. Everything's copacetic, push the limit. That kind of hem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a-nem-a is one of my favorite words in the English language. When I was a kid, my father sat me down and said, do you know what the word copacetic means? And I was like, not really. It means like good and fine and everything's okay. I was like, oh, do you know where it comes from? I was like, no, jazz. Like, copacetic is a great word because it doesn't sound like it's American slang. It sounds like it's some fancy word that, you know, that's been used for centuries. But it's not. It's a modern word. It's cool. Lord I Know is the end of the track. Super Themina Emina Dimina rapping. Nice kind of pre-chorus about being a warrior. Very similar kind of the Kids See Ghost theme here. Just kind of like overcoming things. And it's kind of a beautiful outro and a note of hope at the end of an album that is not hopeless, but it is acknowledging the inescapability of recidivism. Okay, well, there we go. I should go now. I'm gonna have a sip of my coffee. I don't care if you join the rebellion, by the way. You can be a part of the empire and still like new music. It doesn't matter to me. All right, well, for Dan Marino, there's the camera.